evening, folks. Welcome to the Fire Services Merger public forum presentation. Appreciate you all coming out tonight. As you know, the idea of merging the two towns, Ashland and Hopkinton's fire departments, has been under discussion and explored for several years now. In fact, I think the initial discussions probably took place around 10 years ago. Before we get started, I'd like to give a brief overview of the advisory group that's been working on this for the past 2 years, Jamie, approximately 2 years. From Hopkinton, Town Manager Norman Camallo, Fire Department Chief Clark, Union Head Kaz Pierkowski, myself, Selectman John Mosier, and former Selectman Brian Herp. From the Ashland side, Town Manager Tony Schiavi, Fire Chief Scott Boothby, Union President Lieutenant David LaRussi, Selectman Yolanda Greaves, and retired Chief Bill Key. Also like to thank our consultant, Municipal Resources, Inc., and of course the MAPC for offering their project management resources and other legal resources. So tonight's goal is to inform you about the proposed merger. We want to talk a little bit about the challenges that are currently facing the two departments and how these challenges will impact our future, and why merging the town's fire departments is under consideration, the advantages that solution would offer to these challenges, and also what that merger would look like. So the next step after this would be, after this meeting, would be for the two boards of selectmen to consider the information that we received back from the public forums, and then the two boards would have to vote to decide to move the merger forward. Ultimately, though, the voters would decide at an annual town meeting as to whether or not this merger would happen. So what we'll discuss tonight, you can see on the agenda, defining the challenge, some detail on the project background. The chief will go more into the operational details of how we work now. The town managers will go into the specifics of why a merger could make sense. Also the proposed model and what the governance structure would look like, as well as the implementation plan, and time for questions. So the catalyst for these discussions is the challenge we face. As you can see, if you have really good eyesight from this chart, that there's been a combined population growth in the two towns that has increased steadily since the 1980s. Is projected to continue to grow in years to come. I don't think it takes much imagination to see how the traffic now, coupled with the developments that we're seeing and the types of developments we're seeing, and the impact that that'll have on our public safety services. Our fire departments have not added significant amounts of staff since roughly 2000. Which is a number of years ago, and it has not kept pace with the demand on services due to population growth. So that is really what has brought some urgency to this discussion. And as we continue to see more population probably ramping up at an increasing rate, I suspect that going into the later years, we're projecting 6%. I wouldn't be surprised if that was a little bit higher. But at this point, I want to turn the podium over to Chief Clark, and he can go into some of the operational details.
Thank you, John. Chief?
Okay, good evening. My name is Ken Clark. I'm the fire chief in Hopkinton. I'd like to thank you all for coming out on a cold winter's night to share this information with us. The challenges we face, there's probably many people in the room that can confirm this, but the fire department mission in the 40 plus years that I've been there has changed. It was a simple fire department, you go to brush fires, you go to house fires, you help out on the medical emergencies 40 years ago, and it's transitioned into an all hazards department. We do emergency management, we do hazmat, we do the EMS, we do the fire, anything along that, and the whole group has expanded out to include a lot of different things that we assist the community with. Okay? One of the things that is makes a demand on us, as we all know, is that the community and our nation as a whole is aging. So we have to be prepared. It drives a lot of our EMS calls in Hopkinton. And even with some of the buildings that are coming in, I can see over the in our partners in Ashland over the border there, there's a lot of buildings that are coming in that are driven by our aging population. Okay, another challenge that we have is multiple calls. At this time, the volume is not there where it has great demand on the system, but the multiple calls is. At very close to 30% of the time, we have multiple incident responses. When we have one call, whether it be an engine call or an ambulance or something, we get a call for a second or third or fourth, and it's very, very common. I think there was multiple calls Friday morning, Friday afternoon, Sunday morning, and then and just one example of it was that I'd like to share with you very quickly was Sunday afternoon. There was four at the same time, and the second one was for a call for smoke in the building or in the cellar of a house, and the Ashland units responded. And by the time they traveled up there, we had it under control. It was a very minor thing with electrical issue, but they drove by the scene, didn't even get out of the truck, and I walked over with a set of keys to get an in one Knox box, which is a key access box for the high school, and said, go help them at the high school. They get an alarm there. We don't know what's going on. Hand them the keys, and they left Pleasant Street and drove to the high school. So that's what we do on a daily basis. That's just one example. Okay, in the second and third calls trigger calls for mutual aid. And neither department has a deep bench. Okay, we do really good on the first call, or SATA first call if it's a real serious one, but we don't have a deep bench. Our on-call capability has reduced over the years. When I started so many years ago, there was probably 40 call people and 2 to 4 permanent people. And so that when you did a recall or did some type of an alarm for a fire, a majority of those people came in. And Hopkinton started doing career people in 1962, I believe it was. They identified at the time that we were changing from that rural community where everyone slept there and worked in town. It was starting to transition into our mobile society that we see now very, very clearly. So our forefathers had the thought there that we got to start bringing in career personnel. And it's grown. It's taken that long to get where we are. So in those years, since 1962, we've gone from the original two, and then we had 4 people up to the current, what we have now is 24 career personnel in Hopkinton. Okay, and like I said before, we can't rely on our call staff anymore. It's very, very energetic for the people that we have, but the number is down to 3 or 4 active ones. So it's a challenge for us. The ones we have are very good, show up a lot, help out, but it's not something that we can count on all the time. Our staffing levels have not kept up with our growth. As John said a little bit, you saw the chart there before. So that's something that's very, very taxing for us. And it's actually sometimes you come back in, and we know that on emergency calls, sometimes I like to refer to it as we line up dominoes, okay? On a really good call, you might line up a bunch of dominoes, but they don't fall over. But to keep going to emergency calls with insufficient manpower, there's a safety factor that involved, and it lines up the dominoes. And sometimes, and we're very lucky that on that, but we don't want to keep lining up the dominoes every single day for every single incident that we respond to and run into a problem with that. And when they fall, there's serious things that happen. Okay, just a little bit of project background for you. The two previous chiefs, both Chief Doherty in Hopkinton and Chief Key in Ashland, started investigating the possibility of a merger in 2003. We got some of the initial dates up here. Be investigating the possibility of merging the town's fire departments. They looked at it very closely. We have to be constantly be analyzing and evaluating how can we do business better for the community. Okay, so there were some initial white papers that came out in 2008. Then in 2009, there was a joint plan, an organizational structure out of a first phase of a of a consultant came in and reviewed what we had for operational needs on both communities. And then on 2010, there was a second phase that evaluated personnel, equipment, facilities, and budget and operations. In 2012, we had the opportunity to apply for and get the Community Innovation Grants with the partnership with MAPC and the in our consultant MRI, and that was implemented, and it brings us right into the future here. It's been like 2.5 years that this process has been going on with the participation from the two communities, MRI and MAPC, and tonight what we want to do is bring forward those ideas so that you can see and kind of feel those in the town of Hopkinton and get the feedback from you. Okay, one quick thing I'd like to identify here is automatic aid and mutual aid. Automatic aid is a concept that's very common in other parts of the country, but not real common in Massachusetts or even New England. Automatic aid is that the two communities, the two fire chiefs got together and defined a problem, and they analyzed it and said, how can we come up with a better way to do this? We weren't getting enough people on our first alarm to a fire, and Ashland wasn't getting enough on their first alarm to a fire. So what we came up with, the idea was, well, why don't we send a piece automatically? As soon as the phone rings and we have an indication that it may be some type of a structure fire, Hopkinton will automatically send an engine to Ashland, and then vice versa, Ashland will send that tower company to Hopkinton, automatic. As soon as the phone rings, I expect to hear that them on the move or doing a recall by the time I leave my house in the middle of the night to go out to some type of a fire. Been doing it, Chief, how many years have we been at that now?
Oh, at least five.
Yeah, at least.
And
it's been very, very productive, and it also, one of the other reasons that you can say it is the two departments work very, very well together. Okay, and then there's mutual aid. And mutual aid is set up on a run card. Okay, you have first alarm, second alarm, third alarm. That's where most people hear mutual aid. Or if we had multiple incidents and we needed to call mutual aid to Southboro for an ambulance, or mutual aid from Westboro to come to an incident. That's set up on a run card. We know that if we're in that area of town and we need this resource, we call that community for it. And a lot of times you'll hear it on the news, it's like, Boston had a 3-alarm fire, or Framingham had a 2-alarm fire. Some of them might be mutual aid companies. In the bigger communities, it might not be mutual aid, but in a smaller one like ours, that would be moving multiple communities to come in and help. Again, the second and third calls, we talked about it briefly before. That's the most challenging things, and I listen to both communities all the time, and that's our biggest challenge day in and day out, is we have a really good team to go out on the first call, like an engine call or an ambulance call, or the rescue in the ambulance if it's going to the highway. We have and we're working to enhance that. We have the good ability to do that, but it's kind of like a team. Our team is good when it's out on the street, but once they go on the street and leave the station, the bench is very, very empty. So it's like we don't have a lot of resources to call on for backup. And we talk about this as a regional collaboration, the merger. And there's some of the things, and I just want to briefly describe you some of the things that we already do for our regional collaboration is the hazardous materials. If there's a hazmat spill, that's a statewide regional approach to hazmat. They get the state broken into, I think it's 6 zones. And we currently have 2 personnel to assign to those teams. Another way that we do it is a dive team. We have a regional dive team with, right now it's Hopkinton, Ashland, Northboro, Framingham. I know I'm missing somebody. But it's a regional approach in the fire district because one community isn't large enough to sustain the team on its own. So we share the responsibility. The technical rescue team, this has been a very, very big item for the fire district. And it's a technical rescue team. They do anything with high angle on ropes. They do anything on a trench collapse, a building collapse. There's one more discipline I'm forgetting
confined
here.
Space.
I'm sorry, what?
Confined space,
thank you. In the confined space, they do those specialties. They meet monthly, they train monthly, and it's a regional approach. And our fire district is 22 cities and towns, all the way up to Concord on the north side, and they all, everyone sprinkles a couple of guys on it, and that's how we do that on a regional basis for our technical rescue team. Again, that could very shortly go to a state model, very similar to what the hazardous materials do. There's a move now to do that. The fire district, again, another regional a regional project. We belong to Fire District 14, which is a little bit of the communities that are to our west on in Worcester County, and then all the way again, all the way up to into the Concord. We're on the far south of the district. And then this training, we have, it's very common to have training that encompasses the whole district. Years ago, it was much busier that we did initial firefighter 1-2 training with the communities on the south side here for many, many years. That was a very successful effort. Okay, this is just a quick staffing of what we have now. Okay, on the right, on our administrative staff, right now in Hopkinton, we have myself as the chief, Steve Slammon as the deputy. We have a training officer, that is, the position is vacant now. We have a fire engine officer, that's our fire inspector, Tom Poirier, who you see that out on the street all the time for your inspections, okay? And that's our administrative staff, and along with the admin, which is Mary Carver. Then we have four duty groups, which have made up of five firefighters, okay? One of those firefighters at this time is assigned and dispatched to each of those groups, and they rotate it through the four firefighters that are there. And there's a lieutenant lead in that group, and then there's four firefighters, two of which are paramedics. Because we run it's a fire-based municipal advanced life support ambulance system. And the first call they do is either an ambulance call. The duty shift can start that. The duty shift can start the engine call, okay? And if it's a motor vehicle accident, which are about 125 to 150 of those a year that we respond to, It's the rescue and the ambulance that respond to that. And another important thing that we're working on is the public safety dispatch to enhance our capability to put additional people on the street is another program that we get running simultaneous with this. I'd like to have Tom Manager and Norman Kamalo come up now and have his question.
Good evening, and thank you all for making this public forum. And also thank you, John and Chief, for setting the context for my presentation. Why merge? I think if you consider the challenges that we face in Hopkinton and Ashland, as were described by John Moja, and the issues that we deal with on a regular basis, as fire departments, as were described by the fire chief, I think the first reason why we have to merge is simply timing. This is the right time to take the natural step to formalize the fire department's existing relationship into a unified command. What do we accomplish by having a unified command? We have efficiencies in terms of realizing economies of scale in administration and training. We eliminate redundant staffing patterns without eliminating staff. Operationally, currently the two departments combined have budgets that total approximately 4.7 million. And with a combined department, we therefore have the opportunity to achieve economies of scale in terms of capital purchases. A combined capital plan would allow the communities to use greater efficiency when purchasing new apparatus. And as you know, this practice is already in place, where, for example, there's equipment that Ashland purchased, and because of that reason, there's no need for us here in Hopkinton to purchase the ladder. And borrowing from that model, we believe going forward, if we combine the departments, we'll be able to accomplish economies of scale when purchasing very expensive capital equipment. And also, based on our review of the two towns' capital plans, we believe that a merger will allow us to implement the long-term capital replacement plans that have already been identified by the two communities at a much more less expensive scale than if the two towns were to do that individually. By way of illustration, if the two towns were to merge, we project 10 years savings of approximately $2.1 million in capital savings. Only one ladder needed, so there would be no need to replace the Hopkinton ladder, and that's approximately $1.2 million in savings. Only one heavy rescue needed, so there'll be no need in Ashland to purchase a heavy rescue, and heavy rescues cost approximately $680,000. Only two pumpers will be needed per station, so there'll be no need to replace Ashland's mini pumper engine at $300,000, estimated to cost $300,000. And thus, although there are modest short-term savings, long-term savings are significant relative to operational capacity and improved service levels. How will this work? There will be a shared command administration for dispatch, training, facilities, and equipment. In terms of stations, we'll continue to staff three stations, two in Ashland and one in Hopkinton. There'll also be future consideration of staffing a second station in Hopkinton, bringing the total proposed number of stations at full measure to four. And that comes along with cross-deployment of operators and personnel, which is yet to be determined. And we believe that if the merger is going to move forward, that determination would be made by the governing structure working alongside the fire chief for the district. In terms of governance, how will this merger work? In essence, the merger will create a regional fire, rescue, and emergency medical service. The powers granted to this entity will derive from the towns of Ashland and Hopkinton. What that means is this entity will not be a separate sovereign power or separate fire district. It is going to be operated through a joint board. The joint board will require approval of the Board of Selectmen, town meetings of both Ashland and Hopkinton, and approval of special legislation. And within 1 month of the enactment of the Special Act, the towns will be required to create the joint board. As shown on the chart, the joint board will include the two town managers. They will be ex officio members of the board. One member of the Board of Selectmen selected by the respective Board of Selectmen in Ashland and Hopkinton. And there will be one chair jointly nominated by both the town managers and approved by both boards of selectmen. And thus, based on this structure, we believe moving forward, this will be an equal partnership with equal powers granted to each town's town meeting or governance structure. Operationally, as I explained, if you look at the structure at the top, you'll have the Board of Selectmen, who in essence would be the appointing authority working alongside the town managers. The governing body will be, as I described previously, and then the service provider would be through the boots on the ground, working alongside the administration, where you'll have a fire chief with two deputy chiefs, one responsible for administration and the other responsible for operations. Specifically, the fire chiefs will be appointed by and accountable to the governing board. They will be responsible for all the operations and administration of the department. And this comes along with the acceptance by the group that this structure should be based on a strong fire chief concept. The governing body will be the employer, responsible for coordinating and conducting collective bargaining, and it may assume existing or negotiate new mutual aid agreements and other contracts. It will have the power to borrow and bond with the approval of both town meetings. The department revenue will be used to offset the expenses of the joint department. The annual operating and capital budgets will be prepared by the fire chief, adopted by the governing board, and presented to both town meetings for appropriation. The staffing model. As I said, at the top is the administration. And what you see on the board is the level of service that will be available to both towns 365 days of the year. For any shift, there will be two engines, one quint, one rescue, and ambulance cross-staffed, and there will be two ambulances. And based on the staffing structure that I will soon be describing, we will have at least four personnel per engine and two personnel per ambulance. I think one of the interesting discussions during the work of the study group was, how are we going to approach the staffing issue based on the staffing gap that was identified earlier by both the fire chief and John Moja? We came up with a phased implementation program, one that would allow the addition of boots on the ground over several years. Beginning in FY16, there will be four new, in fact, in FY15, January, there will be four new firemen that will join the fire team in Hopkinton. The idea here was, when we worked out on the model, we were hoping that this implementation of the joint dispatch project that we're discussing in Hopkinton will okay in January. We're pretty much advanced in those discussions, and I can say that come July 1, we will have those four firemen joining the fire team and moving out of dispatch. In between 2016 and 2017, there will be eight additional firemen added, four between 17 and 18, another four between 18 and 19, another four between 19 and 20, and in the final year, between 20 and 21, eight firemen will be added to the team. We're hoping to continue the public discussions throughout the spring of 2015. Selectmen will decide to seek town meeting approval to file for a home rule special legislation summer of 2015. That is if town meeting approves the measure. We'll continue working on refining the personnel costs and capital costs leading to the town meeting discussions. We hope to finalize a joint operations procedure by July 2015. The two chiefs are currently working on that document with their teams. And ongoing issues to be determined include the cross-town deployment, dispatch, collective bargaining agreement, and we're hoping that if all goes well, that the joint or merged department will be fully operational by July 1, 2016. Okay, take questions at this point. At this point, we'll take questions.
Yeah, Mavis, can you pop up to the mic?
Mavis O'Leary from Curtis Road. I have a question. Has this model ever been used in other two towns or a combination of towns?
Yes, if you're asking the question in the context of Massachusetts, there is an example in the Cape where several towns have combined their fire services. In the US, this model is very common in I believe the central states as well as the western states.
And it's been successful, I take it?
I believe so.
All right, another question is, will this require a new fire station somewhere between the two towns or somewhere in the middle? I mean,
I can answer that. Yes.
No, this agreement in itself doesn't require a new station. A new station may be required by demand, but this merger wouldn't be the catalyst for a new station.
Okay. Right. Well, I was thinking, I guess, more demand. As I think of these proposed development schemes that are happening in Hopkinton, at least, and I see in Ashland as well with the tall towers, and I think, well, Ashland has a ladder truck, but how would they get through that backup traffic on East Main Street to get out to, say, West Main Street at the Mews? We're going to put a third lane through on 135 for emergencies?
Chief, you want to take access questions?
Well, I think traffic is always an issue, whether it's cars at between 6 and 8 in the morning or snow that we deal with at 2 o'clock in the morning in the middle of the winter. You always want them there as fast as you can, but there's a certain travel time that it takes to get anywhere. And even when we talked about the automatic mutual aid, there's a timetable in that it takes them to get from the Ashland station to the scene in Hopkinton and vice versa. So we know that's there. This plan will make that better. There'll be better overlapping of resources and should improve that. The traffic, we just have to deal with that on a day-to-day basis right now like you do. Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, I see.
Hi.
Hi, Brian.
Hi, Brian. How you doing?
How you guys doing?
Good.
Thank you for the presentation. A couple of questions, if I could. I got to find them first. On the governance, when we have two ex officio and then three others, what's a quorum in that scenario?
Three,
including the two ex officios?
That is correct.
So one non-ex officio, if that makes sense, could make a decision by him or herself. I'd like that job.
Yeah.
We could get some things done around here.
Yes.
So I think we have to look at that.
Yeah. In fact, Brian, to be clear, the two town managers who will be part of the board will have voting powers.
But that's not ex officio.
No, ex officio is simply referring that they are members of the governing board by virtue of their offices.
So it's a standing appointment to the governing board. It's not ex officio.
It's ex officio.
Okay, we'll debate that later.
Yeah.
Second, the staffing ramp up through FY 2021, it's fairly steady and I think starts out at a reasonable pace. But as it grows, is that growing with projected population? Is that why we have it kind of in this path, or was this just the phase in and the budgeting over time?
So this is the best estimate based on population growth, and then take the growth and figure out what your call volumes are. Call volumes could change depending on the type of population that it is and what the demand is. So it's not, I mean, if the population doesn't grow, then you're not going to be adding to those same capacities. If it does, so that's basically just based on the projections that we
have. So these are projections, they're not guaranteed, and they would follow a path dictated by population growth.
Correct.
Okay. And then lastly, perhaps intentionally, I don't see any dollars anywhere in this packet in terms of we saw it early on in the $4.7 million, but I don't see the dollars in the proposed merger and what that new entity's budget would look like in these projected years. Is that something we could see?
So we don't have that in detail. We have some rough estimates from elimination of redundant positions and better coordination on capital expenditures, but those numbers that you're looking for, we just don't have in detail at this point.
So have the models started to look a little bit better with projected growth, projected revenue from that growth, and the projected budget increases in costs? Or is there still a bit of a disconnect there from what I recall?
Well, I think probably the first thing to point out is that this concept doesn't have its ideas in saving money, right? I believe the original concept was to improve operational capabilities. And so what this is meant to do is enhance the operational capabilities of the two departments by unifying them under a command, centralized command. There are estimates for fiscal savings that are part of that. And Norman, do you care to comment further on the fiscal aspect of it? But at this point, we don't have significant details beyond what we've presented so far.
Yeah, we are still refining the calculations relative to finances, financial projections, and tax impact. As part of our discussions, we are also mindful of other opportunities that may be available to offset the cost of implementing the measure. For example, there may be grant opportunities that the joint entity may apply for. I've heard the chiefs mention the safer grants that may be available. Also, I think both towns have in the past done a good job in discussing and getting agreements from developers to mitigate the impacts of large-scale developments. Funding from such agreements may help offset the cost of implementing the joint structure.
Are we talking about having this discussion at town meeting in May, this coming May?
That's
for this schedule, it would have to be this May, right, if we wanted to go to July of 16, right?
That is correct. It may, we're aiming at getting this to the annual town meeting. Depending on the input that we receive from the public, there may be a need to adjust the schedule and consider a special town meeting.
Yeah. Are you guys able to do it in May?
We will probably not have it at our regular May town meeting, because we're already in the process of creating our warrant articles, and we still have to get approval of the rest of our board to bring it to the town meeting. And we had our first public meeting on Monday, similar to this one, and we're still looking to get feedback from our community as to the moving forward.
Okay.
But if we would do it, we'd probably look at a special town meeting probably early summer, only because of what else we have on our warrant articles for May town meeting.
Okay.
I think the other aspect of that, I think that came up at our meeting and some of the questions we had from our residents, you know, something of this nature, which is unique, we're the only ones in Massachusetts yet to propose something like this, is you want to make sure that we can present or we can put the time available to you know, the give adequate time for folks to ask questions. You know, obviously our annual town meetings are very full. There's a lot of things on there. So I think we've talked about some advantages of a special town meeting just because it's going to be able to be focused on something very important that we know folks will have questions on.
And it would be able to answer that financial question that you have, because if you're going to bring it to town meeting, that financial question is going to be there and you need to be able to answer that. And we're still looking at getting correct information so that when we present a number to the communities, it's an accurate number and not just the best guess.
And so this model with this staffing and this timeline, that's all been agreed to by the working group, and now it's a matter of finalizing it and financing, getting the finances lined up.
And then bringing it to the communities.
And that's all right, great. Yeah, with MRIs putting that together for us.
Well, I know you've done a ton of work on this over the years, and it'll be interesting to see how it plays out, but thank you.
Thank you,
Brian, for the effort that you put in the prior year.
Sure. Yeah.
Good evening. Pat O'Brien, 13 Ray Street. I feel like I'm at a town meeting here.
There you go.
And like Mr. Hurst said, as a resident, we appreciate all the time and effort that you put into this, looking into this. I came surely out of curiosity because I couldn't really wrap my head around why, as a resident, I'd want to see this. Being involved in public safety, I will confirm what Chief Clark said earlier. They are well understaffed. I was working last Sunday when we were down Downey Street and then at the high school, Grove Street. I mean, they were all over the place. So the big question I have is, do we need to go to this merger thing to take care of the issues of Hopkinton? First thing that strikes out at me, looking at your chart here, the majority of calls is medicals. You take the medicals and the false alarms, that's 75% of their calls. So for 75% of your calls, are we merging with Ashland? That's really something that's medically driven. Is there another alternative for the town of Hopkinton than merging the two departments and all the equipment, all the brass, all the men for predominantly a lot of medical calls? You mentioned the capital savings over the 10-year period, $2.2 million. What you're talking about pretty much is all equipment. I didn't hear, as Mr. Hurd was asking, cost on the men or the budgets. So, simple math, and I know it's really simple, $2.2 million, savings over 10 years on each department. If you split that in $500,000 a piece spread out over 10 years, it's $100,000 each year that you're asking us as a resident to join into this thing to save. For that $100,000, we got a $70, $80 million budget. So I guess when you look kind of at that $100,000, we may be able to come up with. I guess the bigger thing for me is, in Ashland, you're a fine department, Chief. You come over, you do a great job, and I know a lot of your men, and very well respected. I've always, as far as the police department goes, fire department goes, schools go, I like it in Hopkinton. I like our selectmen, I like our chief, I like our people responsible for our department. Just from the outside, you see regional schools. Algonquin wants a new gym, Southboro's got to pass it, Northboro's got to pass it. Nipmuc, Upton's got to pass it, Menden's got to pass it. So are we going to run into any problems down the line when we need equipment and one town wants it, the other town doesn't? I from what I heard up here, I haven't really heard anything that swayed me to think that it's a good idea. The chief did mention things that you do, the training, you know, the automatic calls, but the regional collaboration, I imagine that's stuff that you'll continue to do. District 14, the dive team, that's all stuff you'll do anyway, whether we join with Ashland or not. So just trying to get the strong points away. As a resident, I would want that. I'll get off of there in 1 second. Because the concern I have, even just seeing what's going on, and something that I'd hate to see would happen, is because of this joint with Ashland, is the automatic of Ashland backing us up. Meaning, if our men are tied up, say, whatever, two calls, and we need an ambulance in Woodville, does the call go to Ashland? So I'm a resident of Woodville. I need the ambulance. Instead of a closer department, Westbrook, coming over with their ambulance, we got to have Ashland come from their main station, go through downtown Hopkinton at a bad hour, and take a longer time to get that. So I appreciate all the effort time put in it. I don't see as a resident why I would want to vote for that. Thank you.
So, well, hang on, Pat.
Okay.
So you had some questions in there at the beginning,
yep.
and I want to get to them. So none of us, certainly not myself, have taken consideration of this lightly for many of the points that you bring up. I love Hopkinton. I love the job that our public safety does here. And although I appreciate Ashland's assistance, I'm sure that they have some similar feelings towards Ashland. So thinking about merging them is not being taken lightly. Is this the only option? It is not. I can't speak for the other board members because they all have to cast their vote just like I do. But I know myself, I will advocate for resources for the department so they can accomplish their mission and continue providing the excellent service that they have, even with the demands of the future. So this is not the only option. If we don't go this route, it's not like the fire department will never see another staff member or anything like that. We'll have to ensure that public safety can do the job that we ask them to do. As far as the savings, as you point out, it's always going to take so many personnel to do the job, and it's always going to take X type of equipment to do the job. And this is where I defer to the chiefs a little bit, and they've said that operationally they believe the unified command will enhance their ability to provide service. That's where I see the benefit. I'm going by what I'm hearing from the chiefs on what they can provide. But I agree that if you look at it purely from a fiscal standpoint, you have to weigh that against the $100,000 to $200,000 savings a year versus what's the benefit to Hopkinton. And to me, there has to be an operational benefit. I can't look at those dollars and justify that as the driving reason. There has to be an operational improvement. So I hear your concerns. So I touched on a couple of things. I don't know if you or Chief want to address a couple others.
In fact, budget-wise, again, Pat, great questions, great comments. I think if we all agree that we are starting off from a point where both departments are short-staffed,
sure.
I agree with that. Therefore, in the immediate and medium term, there cannot be any savings in terms of staffing. That's why I think this model is emphasizing the long-term gains that may come from combining the investments in staffing and comparing them with the long-term gains from the capital savings. And thus, if I was asked the question right now, does this model provide Hopkinton with the best opportunity of addressing the staffing shortage and at the same time giving us the equipment that is required to provide a better level of service in a very safe manner, I would like to believe that this model provides the best chance.
But not the only chance.
Equipment-wise, besides the ladder truck from Ashland, what equipment would we benefit, you know, other than calling over for mutual aid to, if we have an accident when our rescue is already being used or whatever, but what equipment would Ashland have that Hopkinton doesn't have that would benefit from this merger?
Well, I think what has to be looked at is what is the minimum need if they were merged? Is it 3 engines, 4 engines, 5 engines? Okay, identify all those needs. And there's always gonna be a time when you could have 2 rescues and they may be busy someplace. You know that,
sure.
We've been going on calls for a long
yep.
time. Okay, so, but you gotta have that first hit, that first, this sets us up for a good foundation for a serious fire. This sets us up with a proper number of people properly trained to arrive at an emergency scene in an efficient time where it makes a difference. You know better than anybody in the room over the years, if we're a little late for something, the difference that it makes is if we can get there 2 minutes quicker, talking to the choir with you.
Mm-hmm.
So you and I have been there many times. And so this is the best chance that our fire department has to bring an enhanced plan to the community to make it better. Okay, we can still do it on our own, but there's going to be expenses down the road, and this is the way to share the responsibility to get it where both communities need to be. And the concept is new to Massachusetts, but it's very, very common in other parts of the country to take an 80,000 person city and a 60,000 person city in California, put them together and make a fire department. So it's like, is there other ways to do it? Yep. The group has worked 2.5 years to come to this consensus, and the group doesn't all agree on the implementation time. I got to be up front and say that. Some think it should be sooner. Some think it should be in 3 or 4 years or whatever their opinion is, but the group has reached consensus on the 6-year plan. And so it's like, I am totally in on the concept. There's no one in the room here that bleeds green more than me, Patrick.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, and I got to look out for the community, and my community will get a good deal for this.
All right, just so for clarification for me, on this chart, fiscal 16, you got 40 boots, which is currently what the 2 departments have right now, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Hold on. Let me get there, Patrick.
What's that? Right, I'm looking at this staffing now, 21 and 19 for 40, right?
Yeah, that includes everybody.
Yeah. All right, so then 40. So even under this model, we're still waiting to fiscal 17 to add 8 guys?
So there's some other things that come into the equation for, and I can only speak for Hopkinton right now. The public safety dispatch, which you're aware of,
yep.
that puts 4 of our people who currently are in dispatch
yep.
on the street, and the responsibility for the dispatch goes over to the blue team.
Yep.
Okay, so we gain 4 there.
Yep.
Currently on the roll call, but they will go from being in dispatch to the street. So right away, that gains us, as soon as that goes into implementation, that will give us 4 people on the street 50% mm-hmm. of the time, and 5 people on the street 50% of the time, where before that it was 3 and 4. That's
yep.
a huge gain for us right away.
Sure.
There's 2 people in the FY16 budget that is still under consideration for 2 more, and it's 2 from each community. I think Ashland's doing 2, and mm-hmm. and we're doing 2. That's in the budget, and we're still working on that concept for 16, and then it rolls out 17. And an important thing in some of the early meetings when the staff was all there, that it was very, very critical to me, was sustainability. When I look into a group of room of firefighters in a room of police officers, you don't only see a face of a firefighter, male or female, but you see attached to each one of those faces is a family. So you got to make sure that the plan that you have is sustainable. Our financial people, Norman and Tony, have bought in that it's sustainable to do this. Okay, they have said, we can do this, and this is sustainable. You know, some people want to go, oh, we should go higher with it, but it's sustainable. And I don't want to look at one of those faces someday and turn around and say, well, we have to lay some people off because it's not sustainable anymore. So this is what we reached consensus on this model, and we spent a lot of time on it. And like they, like John and Norman said, there are other options. But this is the one that the group with consensus feels is the best one for both communities.
Okay, just my last thing is, and I know, you know, we've got the financial guys looking over that, and obviously we got the administration. And the one guy that's missing next to you is the president of the local union. So just trying to get what's your firefighters think about this merger. Are they supportive of it?
I can't speak for my firefighters on this. They are, I have been told by Kaz that they're 100% behind the concept, but maybe not the timeline. They I have to be honest, they think it should be shortened up so that staffing is in sooner. What exactly, I can't answer that question in how many years, but I know they feel like it should be more investment sooner, okay? And we've got the promises it's sustainable at what you see here. And so, and that's what the group has reached consensus on.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Patrick. Good thank questions.
Good evening. My name is Don Collins. I live at 45 Teresa Road. And just to, so nobody thinks I'm pulling any punches here or anything, I've been a member of both departments, so I do have a little more broad information than most people might. There's no doubt between, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody for the time and effort, certainly, because I know that this is a, you know, just a, it's a huge thing, especially for this region where not many towns have entertained this or even tried the concept or even discussed it. There's no doubt at all that both towns are in dire need of increased manpower, more boots on the ground. This July will be 25 years that I was laid off from the town of Ashland. And at that time, I believe we had two groups of five and two groups of four. And now Ashland has all four groups of four, and they do incorporate civilian dispatchers. So basically in the 25 years, they have added no more boots to the ground over 25 years, and I got some reservations that this might be a little overly optimistic to a degree, that you're going to be able to multiply, you know, like by 400% within the next 5 or 6 years to get the two towns where they need to be with the projected population growth and the call volumes. Safer grants, I heard Norman mention safer grants. I just read in yesterday's paper, the city of Fall River, they're going for additional safer grants. The problem with safer grants is they have a cap on them. You only get that money for a few years, okay, and then you're obligated to continue that funding for a certain amount of time, and then they're facing layoffs again. I know some civil service departments are absorbing some of those firefighters that are in jeopardy of losing their jobs or have already lost their jobs. Mrs. O'Leary here brought up a great point about the traffic, and like Chief Clark said, traffic's going to be traffic, and you just got to deal with it the best you can. However, the stations, there's going to be eventually a need to kind of, you know, the downtown Ashland station, I don't think anybody here will argue the point that that's in, you know, sooner than later, need a repair and renovation by whatever degree, hopefully total replacement. But you know, and then just the locations of the stations. If the manning from Main Street and Ashland is out, and then your next available manpower is coming from Cedar Street, which Cedar Street is even a longer ride, as people that know the geography, you know, do well know. As far as the Mr. Kamalo, he said, I believe you're probably talking about down the town of Barnstable, I believe, has like five different fire departments, and one of those departments is comprised of Centerville, Osterville, and Marston Mills, so that's like three of the villages within Barnstable, okay? And then besides that, there's Barnstable, there's West Barnstable, there's Catuit, I think, but there's multiple little townships or little villages, if you will, that all comprise what's within the town of Barnstable. That is all governed not by a fire district, but the water district. Okay, so they use the funding there's an actual, it's basically like a water tax or an assessment that you pay into your water bill, and that's what funds those departments pretty much throughout the Cape, as far as I know. So that may be another funding mechanism that should be looked at, that may, you know, better lead into this. I think that the idea and the concept is right on the money. You know, there's a lot of regionalization around the country, as Chief Clark has mentioned, and it is the way of life. You've got a lot of county fire departments. If you go and look around, you know, your larger cities and towns will have their own, but then on the outskirts of that, the unincorporated areas, or the other areas of the county, are all absorbed. Some of them have absorbed these small towns, these Hopkintons and Ashlands and Southboroughs and Milfords or whatever, and put them all together under one big hat. I think that the main way you're going to see any actual savings from this is if you do it a little larger. I think the concept is great, and you're starting off with two towns, might be a good place to start, but I think you got to look for the true total savings in equipment. Pat O'Brien was talking about, the savings in your equipment and stuff, I think, is going to be a little larger scale. I mean, you will save some, you know, between the two towns, but it's going to be magnified that much more if you go a little wider. The other thing about the savings, they have the picture up there with $2.2 million over 10 years, but what is the actual cost before you get there? You know, the actual cost that you're paying before you recognize, you know, by buying a new ladder truck, you're going to save this if you know, why not, one of the towns has it versus another one. So I think that, I know that, you know, there was personnel issues, you know, with, you know, Chief Key retiring, and it seemed like a good time to try to put this all together. And I think the concept is great, and I think, you know, we're on the right track here. I just think it might need a little more work before it tries to be implemented. I mean, already we're a little behind the eight ball. Just none of the three stations as they exist right now will handle much more personnel on duty. Okay, and like I said, I know both towns. I know, you know, all three stations, their locations, you know, what the living areas, you know, are comprised of and whatnot. So there's a lot more than just, you know, the fire truck savings. You're going to have to, you know, build and or renovate, you know, those living areas and those fire stations to accommodate either more modern apparatus or additional personnel to live within those stations. And again, I do greatly appreciate all the time and effort everybody's put into this, and it's a job that I'm glad you guys have taken on, and you know, I don't mean, you know, I'm not trying to be one. I'm bought into the concept myself. However, I think it just might need a little more fine tuning, and maybe, you know, look at it either a wider, you know, maybe a few more towns involved in it, or a little more homework, and maybe seeing how some of these county type places may have merged their departments. But again, I applaud your work, and I just wish that more people, hopefully that your home viewership is up, so everybody's watching this at home and more people are getting educated by this. But I wish there were more people here to hear what's been going on and the effort and everything. So again, thank you.
Thank you. You brought up some good points, and one of them was, what if one town wants to fund something and the other town doesn't? If we did enter into this, neither town would be looking for it to fail, but there would be a legislative mechanism for the towns to revert back to independent departments. Your point about the grants is well taken. We would certainly like to take advantage of that, but to Chief Clark's point about sustainability, we would ensure that we had a staffing model that we could sustain once the grant reached the end of its life. As far as expanding the region, it is common out west, as you pointed out. But right now, we're just trying to work with what we got.
No, absolutely. You got to start somewhere too.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You really do. You got to start somewhere. So I do applaud that. You know, and I just think that, you know, I think it is, people around town have discussed it somewhat. They're thinking that they're going to save, like, you know, $2 million next year, but that's really not the whole. You know, they see that at the end of the rainbow, but for right here and now, it might even cost you more money the first few years, you know, to get to those points.
Well, that's an important point that you bring up, and I think people have to understand that to keep pace with the development that we have and to provide the services that we need, we are going to have to spend money either way.
Yep.
Either with the merger or independently.
Yeah.
And some of the things that Chief Clark and Mr. Kamalo spoke about, with firefighters coming off from dispatch and back onto the street, two firefighters in this year's budget that we're looking to push up. We're going to have some discussion potentially moving that up around July to take care of our immediate needs. And that will help, but even beyond that, in kind of the near midterm, we certainly have to plan that out and ensure that they're sustainable levels.
Yeah. Well, and another very good point that Chief Clark made was adding one guy, one more set of boots on the ground makes all the difference. But they're so deficient, both towns are. And I sit home, I have my pager, and invariably three or four times a day, they're recalling off-duty guys. You know, they're doing a general recall, like, hey, anybody that can come in, anybody available. And the townspeople, you know, the town's very lucky that the employees, the firefighters are on the job between the two towns. They're very dedicated, and they do respond when they're off-duty, as long as they're not, babysitting their kids or have, something, more important. But, they drop what they're doing at 2 in the morning or they jump out of bed and respond, and the town doesn't realize how lucky they've been to have dedicated people like that. And, some guys get burnt out after a while, They live a little further out because they can't afford Hopkinton, so they're coming from Auburn or Bellingham. They're not coming from Woodville to the center of town. Like when I get on, you couldn't even make the truck unless you lived in the first, mile right around the center of town because the trucks would be full, And then now you just, you can barely get guys back on recall. Well,
the call firefighter issue has come up, I believe, in Ashland's meeting also. And it's something that the group's aware of, but that we haven't looked into in depth. So yeah. I'm not really sure what we could do about the call firefighter issue. There may be something we could do if we put our heads together, but we've been focused more on the merger.
Oh no, absolutely.
But it is a point that has come up and is worthy of addressing.
But as a call firefighter, which I am, I will just tell you that, I have my own, I am a firefighter, in my real job, I'm a chief at Logan Airport, but I'm not always available. I never turn the pager off when I'm in town. My wife hasn't seen me in a couple of days and I'm at the firehouse, they had a couple of calls and I'm happy to jump in and I'm happy, but it's not about me, but there's just not that many. And then the training commitments and the training responsibilities to maintain those are even tougher now. The regulations to keep them up to date and their continual, renewal of their EMS stuff and fire training skills. There's an impact there too. So it's not just as easy as, having a bunch of guys run down when they hear the bell, So, but again, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
If I may make a comment just related to governance that you brought up, because we did look at a number of different models in particular fire districts, and I'm very familiar with the ones on the Cape. My wife's a member of the Hyannis Fire District. They're governed by an elected board of commissioners. But they're a separate taxing authority. And there's a court case that's going through right now through Hyannis, where at least at this point the courts have ruled that districts are exempt for Proposition 2.5. And so I think as we looked at that and our, obviously our desires about home rule and that sort of thing, that we felt that the governance model that we actually chose provides both communities through their town meetings as their legislative body to really have the say about the budgets for the departments and capital purchase, those type of things, versus bringing in a district which literally would be autonomous and be its own separate taxing authority and not limited by Proposition 2.5. Obviously, there'd be little, control over, how that would, proceed. And I think that's why we ended up, really focusing on this particular governance model, because it really still resides in our typical form of government where we, go through town meeting to get budgets approved and those kind of things. And then just related to the locations of the station, we have a lot of backup data without making the slide presentation too long, but our consultants had mapped all of our call volumes. And interestingly enough, at least at sort of the present time, the actual locations of the stations are actually very relative to the call volume as they exist. Ashland currently right now, our Board of Selectmen is approving to start a public safety building committee. We're looking at building a combined public safety facility. And for fire departments, location is everything. Police departments, not so much because they're out in sectors, but the location of the fire department, because you're there until the horn blows and you get on your apparatus and respond to a call. So, one of the things about this is it's not this or nothing. We're still looking in Ashland about if this doesn't actually happen, we still know we need staff and we still know we need a new headquarters to get out of the downtown area, and so we're looking at those things. But we, in terms of looking at locations, this is still in our mind as far as where that new headquarters may, you know, actually be, you know, be located. So, thank you.
I hope you let Ashland in the house.
You're in his, can't kick you out.
Yeah. Okay. Izzy Asanko, you know, I live in Ashland. And I'm a retired Fremium firefighter. And I just have a couple of questions. I'm going to say it like this. Shame on Ashland, shame on Hopkinton. That's the way I'm going to put it. The reason why I say this is because we've been lacking firefighters in Ashland for 25 years. We haven't hired anybody. And I hear it's the same thing here in Hopkinton. Somebody's not getting the message here in both towns. What am I trying to say? We're talking people's lives here. That's what we're doing. We're talking about people's lives, and we're shot people. We're shot people actually from getting the job done. For instance, the town of Fremium, we had 30 guys on duties. On duty. You're talking about merging Ashland and Hopkinton, which is going to be bigger than Fremium, which is going to be bigger than Fremium. The trucks are going to take longer to get there. I think myself, what I would do is I would try to get at least 6 firefighters on duty at both Ashland and Hopkinton. That's what I would try to do and keep what we have. I like my chief. I like everything about the fire department in Ashland. And I'm sure people from Hopkinton feel the same way about your chief. And I know him and he's a good one. What I'm trying to say is, we're talking about people's lives here. This room should be packed, just like Ashland should have been packed last Tuesday or last Wednesday. I just don't understand it. The community's got to step up a little bit better. More taxes, sure. But when a firefighter comes down to your house, or a police officer, he's ready to do the job. He's got his life on the line for you. For you. This room should be packed. Believe me. I commend the job that you've done to try to merge, but I'm still going like I did, like I told you. I think both towns should start taking care of their own town. We're fine in Ashland, we really are. But we need more guys. I think it's the same thing here in Hopkinton. My ladder truck in Ashland comes here all the time. I know it's mutual aid. That's the way it is. But I'm paying for that ladder. I think Hopkinton should go out and get their own ladder. That's just the way that I feel about it. Sorry. Well, take care of your own town. Take care of your own town. That's all I'm saying.
Well, first of all, don't apologize. I appreciate you coming in and giving us your thoughts. And I get your message, and I understand that
our public safety services are not an investment that you look at as a payback in dollars. Because when you need somebody there, you need them there. And the people that need them don't care how much it costs.
Correct.
So
Ask anybody who set their house on fire, who needed a kid taken to the hospital. Just ask them.
That's right. So I get your message loud and clear.
Thank you.
That you feel that the boots on the ground are the urgency right now and not the merger.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You said it.
Yeah, well, thank you.
You said it. Thank you.
Yes, thanks for the input.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Nobody wants to follow that, do they?
Yeah. Back to follow is.
Sincere words. Any other comments from the group? No? Wrap it up then.
For those of you that came this evening and participated, I greatly appreciate it. Thank you to the group for all the efforts that you put forward. And this merger is an option. It is not the only option. And I have the utmost confidence in our chiefs that they will accomplish the mission regardless of which route our departments take in the future. They provide the town, both towns, with excellent service. And I have no doubt that they'll continue to do that. We're looking for creative ways to meet the explosive demands that both towns are experiencing. And I think anyone driving through both towns will see some of the unique demands, particularly that are coming up on the border between the two towns. And what this merger is an attempt that has the roots in the operational demands and has been promoted thus far by both chiefs. And so we'll continue to take public input, and both boards of selectmen will consider that, and we'll move forward. So thank you very much, and good night.